Sit comfortably. Keep your back and neck erect. Gently close your eyes. Take few deep breathings. Breathe in deeply and breathe out completely. Relax your body, relax your mind. Let us chant three rounds of Omkara. Inhale deeply, inhale. Relax and feel the beautiful resonance of Omkara throughout your body for a while. Slowly join your hands, rub your palms. Keep your palms on your eyes. Gently give the facial massage, neck massage. And slowly open your eyes, looking at your palms. All right. So once again, welcome all of you to this beautiful evening of Guruvara Mind and Beyond series. So today's topic is the secret and significance of Navratri. So now, right now, all of you know that Navratri is going on and today is the sixth day of Navratri, right? So another 3 days are there. And then Dashehara, that is Vijayadashmi. So we'll try to understand what is this Navratri is actually. Is this Navratri really has to do something with the external things what we do, or it has some significance within each one of us? Is there something within us which has to be, you know, overcome, or which represents or symbolizes this Navratri and the other aspects of Navratri what we generally do? As most of you know that I've been working on this particular aspect, ki whatever we are doing externally, outside, does it has any kind of relevance within us? Maybe within our body or in our mind or in our existence. And I keep, you know, researching on this, ki whatever we are doing externally, it may be any puja for that matter. It may be any japa, any mantra sadhana, any healing modality, you know, any sadhana and all those things what we do externally. Why do we do it externally? What kind of changes it brings within us? And when you look at all the, you know, the ancient traditions, whatever we have been following, not only in our Hinduism, but in all the traditions, they are a kind of symbolical, you know, representation of something within us only. Namma olagadene kelavondu bhavanegalu, kelavondu alochanegalu, kelavondu badlavanegalanna tarodakke naavu horagina ella karmakandagalanna maadta irthivi. So whatever karmakandas we are doing externally, everything is to bring some kind of positive changes within us. Everything in this universe is a kind of, I have been always saying that, a lock and key system. Everything is kind of a puzzle. Our all the ancestors, masters have given us a kind of puzzle which we have to crack. If you can crack the puzzle, you'll get the real essence of everything within it. And this Navratri is also a kind of puzzle which we have to crack, which we have to, you know, find the hidden message in this. And when I started working on this, I found some revelations. What these the nine forms of Devi represents within us? What are the demons about which we talk in all the Puranas, all the Devi Mahatmya when we read and when we hear? What kind of representation or symbolizations these demons are symbolizing within us? All that I came to know a little bit of all those things, which we are going to talk today. And finally, we'll do a beautiful sadhana also, Shakti Samagama Sadhana. That is what we'll be doing at the end practically. Okay? All right. So, before I start speaking anything, as you all know, this Thursday is a kind of discussion. You have to involve with me. Unless and until you do not involve with me, it won't be, I'll not be justifying the topic. So, for you all, the question is, according to you, what is Navratri actually? Or what you have been doing in Navratri? Some of your views, some of your practices, in one or two lines, if you can write and send it in the chat box. And then I'll start what I have to speak about this. So what do you people think? What is actually Navratri according to you? Why do we, after all, celebrate this Navratri? And this Navratri is celebrated all over India actually, and in some other part of the world also. No other, many festivals are just, localized festivals. But this Navratri is kind of, it is celebrated all over the India, from north to south and east to west, all over India it is celebrated. So why? Best Navratri wishes to all. Thank you so much. Triumph of good over evil. Wonderful, sir. This is a triumph of good over evil. So it's a kind of, winning the evils and winning over the evils, So destroying evil things and victory of the good things or good. Wonderful, Parmeshwarji. Yes, that's true. Any other, if you want to share, anybody want to share something? Want to say something about this? What is Navratri according to you? I'm sure most of you are more knowledgeable than me, must be doing more sadhanas than me. So this is just a discussion. We are just, discussing something about Navratri. Nine Devi, each day represents one Devi to burn the karma stored within me. Yes, Nagaraji, very true. The nine Devi forms are helping us to burn the karmas within us, or the negative thoughts or negative things within us. Worshipping of Shakti Devis. Wonderful. Karan is saying that worshipping of Shakti Devis. Yes. So we worship the Shakti during these 9 days. Yes. So we'll understand all these things. What is Shakti actually? Whether this Shakti is somewhere outside or it is within us only. These karmas are somewhere outside or these karmas are within us only. So what has to be done? What are the right ways or right understanding about Navratri? All this we'll try to understand today. All right. So whatever I know about Navratri or I have come to know about Navratri, by the way, I would like to tell you one more thing, that in Navratri in Gujarat, we play Dandiya and Garba. I am from Rajasthan, but in Rajasthan and Gujarat, Gujarat is traditional, you must be knowing Dandiya and Garba we play. And I am one of the best Dandiya player actually. I have been winning many prizes when I was playing long ago. From past 5-6 years, I have reduced because my son has, grown up and he's playing now. So we play Dandiya and Garba during these Navratri, Shardiya Navratri. This year, because of Corona, it is not happening anyway. So the secret and significance of Navratri, we'll try to understand today. So before we understand what is Navratri and what is Shakti, let us understand the universe. What is this universe is all about? All the masters, all the Shastras, all the Puranas, all the Vedas have been saying that this universe is created by the combination of two opposites. This whole universe is created by the combination, by the union of two opposites. Like we have day and night, light and darkness. In Chinese, we call it yin and yang. We can call it masculine and feminine energy, male and female, Purusha and Prakriti, Shiva Shakti. And when these two opposites unite together, the creation begins. This is what we have been talking in all our almost all classes, and we have understood that, right? So when two opposites unite together, a male and female unites together, and creation begins. These two opposites, in our tradition, it is known as one is Shiva and other is Shakti. And we also know that Shiva without Shakti is like Shava. Shiva or the masculine energy without the feminine energy or Shakti is like a dead body. Shiva cannot do anything on its own without the interference of the Shakti. So when Shakti and Shiva unites together, then only creation happens, then only everything in the universe happens. Shiva cannot do anything without Shakti, and Shakti, if it is left alone, it can destroy everything in the universe. It can destroy everything in the universe. So Shiva and Shakti are two inseparable energies which are one and the same. It is just like when you light a lamp, we see that it gives us light. But we forget that with light, it also gives heat. And we cannot separate the heat from the light. Wherever there is light, there has to be heat. Heat and light cannot be separated. The same way Shakti and Shiva cannot be separated. Microcosm is part of macrocosm. That is what we have been talking always. And the Upanishad says, Yatha Brahmande Tatha Pinde. Whatever is there in the whole universe, the same thing is there within our body also, or within this pinda also, or this body also. So there is a cosmic body and there is an individual body, human body. So whatever is there in this whole cosmos, the same thing are there within us also. Right? Shiva is inseparable part of Shakti. Navratri is worshipping the feminine energy or the Shakti present in each one of us. So Navratri, or these 9 days, what we worship, actually we are not worshipping something outside. We are worshipping those aspects of energy, those aspects of Shakti, which are already present within us. The external things, whatever we do, they are all symbolical. Ivella sanketika. ನಮ್ಮ ಹಿರಿಯರು, ನಮ್ಮ ಪೂರ್ವಜರು, ನಮ್ಮ ಋಷಿ ಮುನಿಗಳು ಸಾಂಕೇತಿಕ ಭಾಷೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ನಮಗೆ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು. ಆ ಸಂಕೇತಗಳನ್ನು ಅರ್ಥ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡು ನಮ್ಮ ಒಳಗಡೆ ಏನಿದೆ ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಏನು ಅದನ್ನು ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ, ದಟ್ ಅನುಷ್ಠಾನ, ದಟ್ ಯು ನೋ ಪ್ರಾಕ್ಟೀಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ವಿ ಡೂ ವಿದಿನ್ ಅಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬ್ರಿಂಗ್ ಅಸ್ ದ ರಿಸಲ್ಟ್ಸ್, ನಾಟ್ ವಾಟ್ ವಿ ಡೂ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟರ್ನಲಿ. ವಿಲ್ ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಇನ್ ಡಿಟೇಲ್ ವಾಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ, ವಾಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಶಕ್ತಿ ಈಸ್. So what is Navratri? In general, what we do, what we know about Navratri is, Navratri is the biggest festival celebrated across India and other parts of the world. As I told you, Devi or Shakti is worshipped during Navratri. In these 9 days, we worship Shakti or Devi. Devi Aradhana or Durga Aradhana and all those things we do. Devi means Shakti or Prana Shakti or Kundalini Shakti. We have all heard about those who are from yoga background and spiritual background. They all know about the Prana Shakti or Kundalini Shakti. That Kundalini Shakti is the feminine energy which is present in each one of us in the Muladhara Chakra. And that Shakti itself is the Devi, or the Aradhana of that Shakti has to be done. There are 4 Navratris in a year. Some of you may be knowing, some of you may not know that there are 4 Navratris in a year comes actually. 2 are the called as Gupta Navratris and 2 are Prakata Navratris. Gupta Navratris are, they are not openly celebrated. Gupta Navratri is mainly celebrated or practiced by those who are practicing Tantra Sadhana and the yogis, some yogic practices are done during that Gupta Navratris. And two are the Prakata Navratri. One is the Chaitra Navratri, and the second is this Navratri. What we are celebrating now is known as Sharadiya Navratri, what is going on right now. And this is the biggest Navratri we celebrate, and everybody knows about only this Navratri. And that is why this Navratri is also known as Mahanavratri. It is also known as Mahanavratri or Sharadiya Navratri, we call this. So this is the biggest Navratri among all the four Navratris. In those four Navratris, two are the Gupta Navratris, about which many people do not know, the common people do not celebrate that. Those two Navratris are meant only for the Tantra Sadhakas and the Yogis. And two Navratris is generally for when is the Chaitra Navratri during the Yugadi time and all that. The Navratri comes, that one. And the second is this Navratri or the Sharadiya Navratri. Sharadiya Navratri means the Navratri of the wisdom or knowledge. So the significance of Navratri. What are the significance of Navratri? Every month after new moon, the first 9 days are Navratri, or they are dedicated to Shakti. So first 9 days after every new moon or Amavasya, the first 9 days are dedicated to the feminine energy in the universe. So every month actually Navratri comes. Every month we have Navratri. After Amavasya, first 9 days are dedicated to the Devi. Nava means nine, we all know, and Ratri means night. So Nava, Ratri, have you ever thought why this is Ratri? Why not day? Why we do not celebrate this during the daytime? Nine Ratri, Nava Ratri we celebrate. Why not 9 days, Nava Dinas? So night is basically feminine in nature. First thing is, when you take day and night, day is masculine in nature, night is feminine in nature. Ra means Ratri. In Sanskrit, Ra means that which gives solace. Ra means that which gives solace. And Tri means Tapatreya, or three times of suffering. Those who are from yoga background, they must be knowing that what are these three times of suffering? Tri with the tapa we call it, or Trapatreya we call it, or three times of suffering we call it. When it comes at the physical level, we have physical and mental and causal. Three kinds of suffering we have. In yogic terminology, when we talk about Adi Daihika, Adi Daivika, and Adhyatmika suffering. There are three kinds of suffering yoga talks about, yogic scriptures talk about. And we suffer only by these three sufferings. And Ratri is something which gives solace to all these three kinds of suffering. Ratri literally means for turning inward and rejuvenation. So generally, every day, from morning to evening, you'll be walking. And when you come home at night, and after having your dinner, you sleep. What generally happens is you get rejuvenated throughout the night. You come out of all your suffering when you're sleeping. Right? So whatever pain you have in the body, you experience that pain. Whatever trauma, stress, tension, worries you have in the mind, you experience that mind, the problems in the mind, only when you're awakened. In your deep sleep, there is no physical pain, there is no mental pain, and there is no other causal pain or anything else. So when you're in deep sleep state, you do not have any pain at all, any suffering at all. And that is why Ratri or night is meant for that rejuvenation, and it is just turning inward. When you turn inward, all the suffering are only external. When you look outside, when you see outside, all the suffering are there. Solutions comes from within, and night helps us to go deep within us. So the Ratri means that which gives solace to the soul, to the mind, to the heart, and which helps us to overcome or to win these three kinds of sufferings. Tapatriya, three types of suffering: physical, mental, and causal. What is the importance of nine? Why nine? Navratri sadhana can give us a new birth. Just like we used to be in mother's womb for 9 months, each day of Navratri And why this time is important, we'll also talk about that also. Why these 9 days only? You know, all the 9 days can give you solace. All the nights actually gives you solace. But why this period, this time is very important, we'll talk about that also. So 9 months we used to be in our mother's womb, and each day of Navratri is like you're spending 1 month in your mother's womb again. It is just like by after doing 9 days of sadhana, you take a kind of new birth. You emerge out as a new person. This is how Navratri helps us. Three Shaktis are there. Most of you must be knowing this. Ichha Shakti, Kriya Shakti and Jnana Shakti. Ichha Shakti is willpower. Kriya Shakti is action. And Jnana Shakti or Jnana Shakti is wisdom, knowledge. So these are the three powers. And these three powers we have been, you know, worshipping as Kali, Lakshmi and Saraswati. So the Ichha Shakti, to get anything in our life, we need these three Shaktis. Ichha Shakti, you should have the willingness to get something in your life, to create something, to achieve something in your life. Kriya Shakti, only if you have the Ichha Shakti, that you have the willingness to get something, you cannot get that unless and until you do not act on that. Right? So whatever you want to get, say for example, you want to build a house. Or you want job in your life, just you have finished your degree or education and now you want a job. So you have the willingness that you want a job. Now what is next? You have to take action on that. You have to apply for the job. You have to face the interviews, go for the interviews and all those things. And then after action or Kriya Shakti, you need Jnana Shakti or Jnana Shakti. That is wisdom or knowledge. So if you don't have the wisdom, if you don't have the knowledge, can you, you know, go through the interview or something? You need knowledge to get anything in your life. So these three Shaktis, when work together within us, we can achieve anything in our life. All the three Shaktis are important. And that is what we have been worshipping from time immemorial, Kali, Lakshmi and Saraswati. Kali can be Durga or Parvati, whatever we call it. And Lakshmi and Saraswati. These are the three Devis we have. These Devis are nothing but, these are the symbolical form of the energy which is present within each one of us, right? So Ichha Shakti we have to have, and we all have that. It has to be awakened. Kriya Shakti we all have that. We all can do something. It has to be awakened. If you are lazy, you cannot do anything. Laziness is a demon. We'll talk about that. And Jnana Shakti or wisdom, we all have that. We all have all kinds of knowledge. It is not that only I know or only somebody knows. We all have all that knowledge within us. It is just that you have to manifest that outside. And that is what Swami Vivekananda said. Education is the manifestation of the wisdom which is already present in men. We all have that wisdom that has to be manifested outside by whatever we are doing externally. Wisdom is already there within each one of us. Each soul is a potentially divine. That is what Swami Vivekananda says. We are all potentially, we all have that potential that has to be awakened, that has to be brought out, that has to be manifested outside. Right? Like that, we also have Yoga Shakti, Bhoga Shakti and Swatantra Shakti. Swami Sri Ravi Shankarji talks about this. I heard from him about these three Shaktis, Yoga Shakti, Bhoga Shakti and Swatantra Shakti. Like we have Yoga Shakti, we have Bhoga Shakti also. You have to have the energy for Bhoga or energy for enjoying everything. If you don't have the energy to enjoy something, say for example, if you have sweets, all kinds of sweets in front of you, and if you're a diabetic, you cannot eat those sweets. That means you do not have that Bhoga Shakti within you. Just an example like that. You have to have that Bhoga Shakti also to enjoy, enjoy this worldly possessions, whatever we have. And we have three gunas also. The yoga and all the scriptures talk about three gunas, tamas, rajas and sattva guna. We are all, this whole universe is trigunat. Maka Antanav Heltivi, This whole universe is a trigunatmaka. That means this whole universe has three gunas in it. And we all have to have these three gunas. These three gunas has to be balanced in our system. If these three gunas are also imbalanced, we'll have all kinds of problems and suffering in our life. So three gunas, tamas, rajas and sattva has to be balanced. And three gunas into three shaktis is nine. So each energy has three gunas. Three energies we have. Three energies into three gunas into three into three is nine. And that is why nine is very important. Doing sadhana for 9 days is important because we are addressing the three energies within us and also the three gunas in each energy we are addressing. And we also know in Jyotisha we have 27 nakshatras. So 27 nakshatras are also divided by three, the three gunas or three shaktis, and that also comes to nine. And that is why 9 days are very important. So demons are symbolical, as when you read Devi Mahatmya or any, you know, the stories of Durga, Kali and all those things. I have been always talking that they are not as they are depicted. Everything is symbolical. The Kali is symbolical. The Durga is symbolical. The Parvati, Saraswati, Lakshmi, they are all symbolical. Shiva, Brahma, Vishnu. We have been talking about all these devas and devtas and all these things. These are all symbolical stories. Everything is present within us. In some other form, it is depicted, or the God or that energy is personified to make us understand. But we generally take the literal meaning of all these things. Anyway, let us understand what these demons are, you know, symbolizing in these stories, Devi Mahatmya and other things. So demons means asura, we call it, like asura, rakshasa or asura. Sura means sur. We all know sur is what? It's a rhythm. Sur is a rhythm. Asura means the one who is not in tune or rhythm with the nature. Asura simply means the one who is not in sura. The one who is not in rhythm. The one who is not in tune with the nature. Tune with the divine nature or the nature. The one who is not in tune with the nature is asura or demon or rakshasa we call. Deva means all the good qualities in us, and rakshasa means all the bad qualities in us. We all have heard that story of two wolves. One is bad wolf and one is good wolf. That grandpa tells that story to the, you know, grandchild. We have all heard which wins, which you feed the most, the bad wolf and the good wolf. That is nothing but the rakshasa and devas. So which do you feed the most, that will win. And that is what the Devasura Sangrama is also about. Devasura Sangrama did not happen somewhere else. It happens all the time within us only. We always fight with the bad and good. We always fight with bad and good. Suddenly you get something which is not yours, but nobody is seeing and you want to take it. Something is going on within you. Say for example, you have, somebody has kept 1 lakh or 10 lakh rupees in front of you and he has forgotten and nobody is seeing that now. That 10 lakh rupees is there in front of you. Nobody is seeing you. And now the yuddha happens within you. What should you do? You are in need of money. Should I take that money and keep inside and say that I have not taken it? Or should you return it to that person to whom it belongs to? That sangrama, that fight goes on within us. That fight is Devasura Sangrama, which happens all the time in many situations. We face these kind of situations, these kind of, you know, situations in us, our life. So that is all symbolical. Devasura Sangrama is a symbolical story. So everything depicted in Puranas are symbolical representation of something. The forms of Devi are symbolical representation of the energy present in us. The different demons are symbolical representation of the bad qualities in us. Let us understand them one by one. Okay. So these are the demons we talk about, right? Shumbha, Nishumbha. Just a second. So these are the names of the demons we get in our scriptures, in Devi Mahatmya and all those scriptures. Shumbha and Nishumbha. The first demons are Shumbha and Nishumbha. Literally the meaning of Shumbha is doubting. Doubting self. And Nishumbha is doubting others. The Bhagavad Gita says that Samshay Atma Vinashyati. Samshay Atma Vinashyati. The one who doubts everything cannot get anything either in this world or the other world. This is what Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. And we all have doubt. The one who has doubt, who has been doubting the self and others, cannot achieve anything in their life. So this doubting nature of the self, doubting the self and doubting others, has to be destroyed by some energy within us. That energy within us, when destroys your doubt and doubting others, you are actually killing Shumbha and Nishumbha within you. Shumbha means doubting self and Nishumbha means doubting others. The meaning of these words, these letters, are that. They are not some demons outside. Doubting self and doubting others. When you overcome this bad quality within us. Because when you doubt everybody, when you doubt yourself also, always when you doubt, I cannot do this, whether I can do this or not, you'll not be able to, push yourself. You have to overcome this doubt. And you have to trust, you have to learn to trust the people also. Right? So, Shumbha and Nishumbha is nothing but that doubting self and doubting others, nature of us, which are the demons. Dumra Lochana. See the word. Dumra means blurred. Lochana means vision. Blurred vision or smoky vision. When you have blurred vision, not at the physical level, that means at the knowledge level, as the wisdom level, when you do not have the clear vision, you cannot see the reality outside. And when you cannot see the reality outside, you get doubts on the others, you also get the doubts on the self. And by the way, this Dumra Lochana, in the story they say that he was a senapati of Shumbha and Nishumbha. Right? That story, you might have all heard about that story. The Devi comes to kill Shumbha and Nishumbha, and Devi was so beautiful that these people, Shumbha and Nishumbha wanted to marry the Devi, and she said, yes, I will marry you, but you have to fight me and win. And then they said that we need not fight with a lady, for that our, small senapatis or the generals are enough. And they sent that general, Dumra Lochana and Chandamunda. Right? So Dumra Lochana is the blurred vision. When you do not have the clear vision of the mind, of the wisdom, you cannot see clearly outside. And when you cannot see clearly outside, you get those doubts. So your blurred vision has to be cleared. You have to overcome that. That is the killing Dumra Lochana. Chanda. Chanda means having only the head. Chanda means literally means head. Somebody when you have in your life who never listened to anybody, who always is a kind of egoistic person, who never take concern of anybody, whatever he or she says is always right. We call them heavy-headed person or big-headed person. Right? So that heavy-headedness, that ego, that not listening to anybody, only living in our head, only working with the head, has to be, that is a kind of negative, aspect of us, has to be overcome. That is Chanda. Munda means no head at all. Munda means only the body, no head. Without head, only the body. Without head means a completely dumb person who cannot be communicated. You cannot communicate anything with that person. You cannot say anything to that person because that person is not at all in a position where he or she can understand anything. No head at all. When you do not have head at all, when you cannot be communicated, what can be done to you? Right? So that is Munda. Mahishasura. We have all heard about this demon. You know, Mahisha means buffalo. Mahishasura means buffalo. Hindi mein hum kehte hain na gayi bhais pani mein. Suna ye dialogue aapne? Gayi bhais pani mein. The buffalo is a symbolical representation of the inertia, of the laziness, of the lethargy. Gayi bhais pani mein, that means when a buffalo enters in the water, it will not come easily out. And that is why this kahavat we have in Hindi, gayi bhais pani mein. That laziness, that lethargy, that dullness, that inertia within each one of us is Mahishasura. And if you are lazy, we have seen in our life that there are people who have a lot of opportunities in their life, but they are so lazy, they are so lethargic that they don't even just get up and do something. If just they get up and do something, they can get many things, but they don't do that. So much of lethargy, so much of laziness. And you know, when you have lethargy and laziness, it swallows all the good qualities in you. You may have knowledge, but if you're not expressing that knowledge, ayyo, yaar maartare bidi? Kaun jayega? Kaun karega? You know, when you have that kind of attitude, that is Mahishasura within us. That is dullness, inertia. That is lethargy, laziness within us. That has to be overcome. The energy within us, when wins over this laziness or lethargy, that is the killing of Mahishasura. Rakta Bija. We have spoken about this Rakta Bija in our Pitru Tarpana Dhyana, when we spoke about genes and all that. Rakta Bija, just imagine, just see the name. Rakta means the blood, Bija means the seed. Wherever they say in the story that wherever the one drop of that, Rakta Bija, Raksasa fell, that one drop became the whole Rakta Bija, the whole one demon, new demon. And we have been, listening, hearing in the science background now that they are doing cloning of all these things using the genes. And you all know about the genes and genetic disorders and all those things. Those genetic disorders, what we have within each one of us, which we are carrying from our ancestors from thousands of years, that has to be overcome. And story behind this is also because that king and the business person lost all their, money and all the possession. It is because of that dullness within them. It is because of that Rakta Bija Raksasa, or that, the problem or disorder in the genes. Because of that problem or disorder in the genes, they lost everything. And that Devi or that Shakti, when that got awakened, it kissed that Rakta Bija, is nothing but solving or resolving that genetic disorder and coming back to the order. That is what is the meaning of Rakta Bija. And all other demons, whatever you take, the names are symbolical. Demons are symbolical. These are all the vices, all the bad qualities which are present within each one of us. That has to be overcome. How? Only by Shakti. Only by Shakti. Because without Shakti, Shiva is like Shava. Shiva or Purusha and Prakriti. Without Prakriti, Purusha cannot do anything. So Prakriti or Shakti or that feminine energy, and that is why in our Indian ethos, in our Indian cultures, we have been worshipping the woman. Woman is equalized to the Devi. Woman cannot, without woman, men cannot do anything. And that is why we say that a man becomes complete when he gets married. A woman becomes complete when she gets married. This is what our masters, our scriptures, our ancestors have been saying. because a man till he is single, he is not single actually, he is half only. A woman till she is single, she is not single, she is half only. This is what our concept actually, our Indian concept is actually. When men and women unite together, they become one. They become complete. Because this is half and this is half. And this is how the whole universe is working. This is how the whole universe is created by the combination of these two opposites. When these two opposites become one, the creation begins. Right? Let us understand the nine aspects of Shakti now. We have been worshipping nine aspects of Shakti during these 9 days. So there are different names for that. Let us understand those one by one. Shailaputri. The first day of Devi Aradhana, when we do Navratri Puja, the first Devi is Shailaputri. Shaila is mountain. We all know Himalaya's Putri or mountain or peak. It is born out of peak experience, height of energy. When you have height of energy, when you have too much of energy, or when you have any peak of any experience, once that energy comes out by the peak experience, that energy is known as Shailaputri. And how does it come? The peak of anything you can achieve by your commitment, by complete faith and firmness. Dridhata se aap jab kuch karte hain jeevan mein, तो आप एक्सपीरियंस के हाइट पर पहुंचते हैं, और जब एक्सपीरियंस के हाइट पर आप पहुंचते हैं तो वो एनर्जी जो आपके अंदर है, वो शक्ति जो आपके अंदर है, वो जागृत हो जाती है और वो ऊपर पहुंचती है. उस शक्ति का नाम है शैलपुत्री. आर यू गेटिंग? शैलपुत्री इज नॉट सम वुमन आउटसाइड. दैट एनर्जी विच अवेकन्स विद इन यू व्हेन यू डू एनीथिंग विद कंप्लीट commitment and dedication, complete firmness, complete faith, that energy which awakens within you is Shailaputri. Brahmacharini. Brahma means infinite. This whole universe is infinity or infinite. Charini means that moves within the infinity. Brahmacharini means that energy which is all pervasive, all pervading. The energy which is all pervading, which is moving all over. Brahmacharini also means virgin or pure aspect of energy. Brahmacharya we talk about. Brahmacharya is not celibacy. It's again big topic. I'm not going to talk in detail about this. Brahmacharya is not only celibacy. Brahmacharya is Brahmane Charati Iti Brahmachari. The one who leads the life of Brahman, or the one who leads his life or her life with the Brahman, is Brahmachari. It's a big concept. Again, we'll take some other time. So Brahmacharini is that energy which is all pervading, which is present in the whole universe everywhere. The other meaning of that is the purity, the virginity. That is Brahmacharini. That you get by discipline, good conduct, and practice of purity. When you practice the purity. Purity doesn't mean only the purity of the body, purity of the mind, purity of your action, purity of all those things what you're doing in your life. So when you practice that purity, when you practice that discipline, when you practice the good conducts, you get that energy. That energy, that aspect of energy awakens within you. That is Brahmacharini. The third aspect is Chandraganta. Chandra means moon, and moon is connected with mind. The energy which charms and controls the mind is Chandraganta. The energy within you which charms and controls the mind is Chandraganta. How do you control your mind? By alertness, by being readiness, having readiness, and by refining your mind. By all the sadhanas or meditation and whatever we do, when we refine our mind, when you have the control over your mind, that energy which helps you to take control of your mind and to, you know, make your mind shining, like you can use your mind to create some positive, some great things in your life. that energy is Chandraghanta. Kushmanda. Kushmanda literally means the ball of energy. It is also compared to pumpkin. In all the vegetables, pumpkin is said to be having highest prana energy in it. It has a lot of medicinal quality in it. And that is why when we do all the pujas in the South generally, South India generally, they bring the pumpkin and they break pumpkin out of the house. It is just that, it is again that that tradition is also symbolical. When you break the pumpkin, it releases the positive energy, it releases the prana energy, which has to be filled in the house. That is the concept behind that. But just by breaking the pumpkin, you cannot get the energy. You have to make the palya and eat it. Okay. So pumpkin has a lot of prana energy in it. And that is why that pumpkin is also, you know, compared with Kushmanda. It's a ball of energy. How do you get that? By your growth, by your positivity, by your possibilities in life. So you get prana energy or that shakti or that driving force when you see some possibilities in your life. Right? When you have to do something, when you see that, yes, if I do this, I can get that. That possibilities when you have in your life, that possibilities when you have and that awakens some energy within you, that energy is Kushmanda. That complete prana energy, the positive energy within you is Kushmanda. Skanda Mata, the mother of wisdom, courage. Skanda Mata, the mother of Skanda Kumara or Kartikeya, we know as we know. Kartikeya is what? He's again Senapati, the leader in the Sainya. That is what? Courage. The courage, when do you get the courage? When you have the wisdom. Right? So when you have the wisdom and courage, with that, when you are merciful and you love self and others, that energy which awakened within you is Skanda Mata. Have the power and don't use it. You should have the power, but you have also the control of that power. When you have the control of that power, you'll not use that power for the wrong things. You'll use that power for the betterment of the society, for the betterment of the people around you and for yourself. That energy within you when awakens is Skanda Mata, known as Skanda Mata. Katyayani. Katyayana literally means to see. Katyayani means seer of everything. That is the intuitive abilities within you. Seeing beyond the senses, whatever your five senses can see, when you can see beyond the senses, that is sometimes, you know, when a person comes in front of you, he or she talks very politely, very nicely, and within you, your external senses says that everything is fine. But within you, some energy is there which says that there is, you know, something, some gimmick in this. Be careful. That energy, that power, that intuitive ability, that energy is Katyayani. And that comes when you have the habit of sharing, nourishing self and others, and when you have good relationship, when you try to build good relationship, energy gets awakened within you. That energy is known as Katyayani. Kala Ratri. Kala has two meaning. Kala, one Kala is time. Kala means time. The other Kala is black or dark energy or the dark matter. The dark matter brings solace to heart and soul. It by rest, by calmness, by introspection and reflection, what you are doing, what you are going, swadhyaya, studying the self. When you study the self, you get that knowledge from within. You get that solace about everything. And that, you know, that dark matter within you, which gives you solace. And by that solace, the energy awakens. That energy is known as Kalaratri. Mahagauri. Gauri again has two meanings. One is the beauty, and second is the wisdom or knowledge. Mahagauri is the great knowledge or the great beauty, purity and wisdom, which makes us to move in life and also liberate us from all the bandhanas. So when you're pure, when you're continuously moving in your life, when you have that beauty and wisdom of your mind, your jnana or your knowledge, that awakens some energy within you. That energy is known as Mahagauri. And the last is Siddhidatri. Siddhidatri. Siddhi means perfection, accomplishment, completing something. Miracles. Siddhi means miracles. Siddhidatri means that energy which gives you perfection, which gives you accomplishment, which completes something in your life, which can make miracles happen, which can make impossible possible. That energy, that power, when awakened within you, which helps you to accomplish something in your life, to, you know, reach to the peak of your experience, to reach to the peak of your accomplishment, that energy is Siddhidatri, and that energy also has to be awakened from within. So these are the 9 different names what we have been worshipping during these 9 days. These are the energies which are present within each one of us that has to be awakened. When these energies are worshipped or these energies are awakened within us, these energies help us to win over all these demons called Shumbha, Nishumbha, doubting self, doubting others, you know, laziness, lethargy, and all those things. That is, in right sense, you are celebrating Navaratri. So this is Kali. We have all been depicting Kali as this. A very Bhayankara. The moment you see Kali, you get fear, right? This is so fearful. You know, the tongue is out. She has all those and that rosha and that anger and all those things. Cutting everybody's munda and all those things, you know. This is again symbolical. What does this represent? Kali, the dark energy of the universe which gives knowledge and wisdom. Kali is nothing but the dark energy of this whole universe. And we have been always talking that from darkness, actually, anything new is coming out of the darkness. The black hole in the universe, nobody knows anything about that black hole. The dark matter or dark energy, we only know that there is some dark matter, and that dark matter is maximum part of universe is dark matter. We do not know anything about that. And that is what our Shastras gave it a form by, in the form of Kali. That Kali awakens the wisdom within us. It has a broken hands tied. That means can't do anything on itself. You cannot do anything without that power. She cuts all the hands of the, you know, demons. Tongue out. When you take out your tongue, you cannot speak anything. Complete silence. You cannot explain anything. Not explaining, relaxing, calm, you know, being calm, not talking much. That symbolizes the tongue out. Head in hand, ego and other vices. So head is cut. The head is cut means what? The head is nothing but your ego. It represents your ego, chanda. And the other vices. All the negative qualities come from the mind only, not from the heart. And the mala of heads, she's wearing the mala of heads. That is, you know, bringing all the different ideas together. There are, you know, jitni khopdiya hoti utne ideas aate. When you are working in a team, say for example, those who are working in some companies, when you're working in a team, and if 10 people are there in the team, when all the ideas come together, you'll be able to achieve something great in your team work. But if your ideas, you know, somebody is saying something and the other one is saying something, if your one is going in the north, the other is going in the south, the other in the east, the other in the west, you cannot produce anything. You cannot be productive. So bringing all ideas together represents that mala of the heads. And horrible look is what? Deep fear. That deep fear, if it can be your mother, it will remove all your fears. If you are scared of something, which is small thing, and the biggest fearful thing, if that can be your mother, if you can worship her as your mother, all the fear dissolves. And that is why the horrible look of that mother, Kali. Shiva is a peaceful element, or Shanta Tattva we call. Shiva is a Shanta Tattva. Shiva can hold or stop Kali. We have all read that in the scriptures. Right? The Shiva is nothing but that Shanta Tattva within us. When you're calm and relaxed and serene, you can hold the Kali. And when you can hold the Kali or that dark matter or that wisdom or knowledge, you can accomplish, you can achieve anything in your life. That is the concept of Kali. With calmness, you can use energy positively. So when you are calm and relaxed and serene, you'll be using whatever powers you have positively, and you'll not destroy or destruct something in life or other's life. Durga, the concept of Durga. Durga Mata is sitting on the lion. Durga means difficulty. Durga means difficulty. Durga means one which is closed. When you are surrounded by difficulties, your difficulties have become like a durg or a complete, you know, packed in the difficulties. Durga is one which helps us cross the ocean of samsara, or which helps us come out of all our difficulties, is Durga. And Durga is sitting on the lion. Lion means what? Lion means power. Lion represents power, right? Lion is very strongest animal in the forest, jungle. Lion means power. You should ride your power. Power under your control. That means whatever power you have, you should ride your power. Your power should be under your control. If that power becomes uncontrolled, it will destroy the whole world. Right? So power should be under your control. When you control whatever powers you have, you'll be able to use those powers positively. If you take the example of atom bombs, atomic power, if atomic power is gone in the wrong hands, it can destroy the whole earth. But the same atomic power, when it is used productively, when it is used positively, it is creating so many good things in our life. It is giving electricity, it is giving power, it is running so many things just by atomic power. The same power is used constructively, positively. So you should have the control over your power. That is depicted as Durga Mata. And trident, Trishula is those three energies, wisdom, love, and action. When you have wisdom, when you have love for everybody, and when you're able to act, that represents the Trishula in Durga Mata's hand. Anyway, this is very important aspect of today's, the whole class, the whole lecture actually. Those who have learned Reiki or yoga, those who know yoga, they know all about nadis. We have 72,000 nadis in our pranamaya kosha. I'm not going to go in all those details now. Out of which three are important nadis. The left side of your nose is known as Ida nadi. The right side is known as Pingala nadi. And at the center, we have Sushumna nadi. And those who have been doing any sadhana or any practices, generally they teach you Nadi Shuddhi Pranayama before you practice any yoga sadhana or any meditation or whatever. So when you do the Nadi Shuddhi, that means when you balance the two nadis, the left and right nadis, or Ida and Pingala, what happens is your consciousness starts flowing in the Sushumna Nadi. I repeat. When you balance your left and right nadis, when you balance your Ida and Pingala nadi, when two nadis are balanced, the consciousness, the energy flows in Sushumna nadi. And when your both the nadis are balanced, your awareness flows in the Sushumna Nadi, and that is very, very, very important time for sadhana. When your consciousness is flowing in the Sushumna Nadi, it is very conducive for your sadhana. It is very conducive to reach to the peak of your experience in the spiritual practice, right? And this can be multiplied when you have the support of the whole universe. Whatever you are doing at your home, if you are doing something and there are 4 people in the house and 3 of them are opposing you, there are chances that you may not succeed in doing that, right? But if all these 3 people are also supporting you to do what you are doing, there are maximum chances that you will succeed in getting that. Correct? The same way, when your energies are flowing in the Sushumna Nadi, the individual body, and when the same Nadi is active in the cosmic energy or the cosmic body, that helps you to reach to the peak of experience very fast. And scripture says that, Sauravagnana says that, during these Navratris, all these 4 Navratris, especially this Navratri, these 9 nights, the consciousness of this whole universe is flowing in the Sushumna Nadi of the cosmic body. That means right now, it is just like you're trying to reach to your destination. You're standing like this and a big force is pushing you from back. It is helping you to reach to your destination very fast. And this is what is happening during Navratri. During Navratri, the Sushumna, you know, the consciousness flows in the Sushumna of the cosmic body. Sushumna is important nadi for sadhana. Consciousness flows in Sushumna in the cosmic body during Navratri. And this is very important. And that is why when you do any sadhana during Navratri, this gives you maximum result. Maximum results, because the whole universe is conspiring to give you what you want in your life. This is the beauty of this Navratri. This is very important of this Navratri, that this Navratri or all the Navratris during these important Navratris, 4 Navratris in the year, especially this Sharadiya Navratri, the cosmic energy is flowing in the Sushumna Nadi in the whole cosmos, and that is very conducive, very useful to get any peak experience in our life also, in our sadhana also. And that is why Navratri is very important. So Navratri sadhana, what generally people do is, Navratri sadhana is the opportunity to overcome all the negativity or the negative tendencies. Whatever negative tendencies we have, in each one of us, we are all, you know, we all have vices, we all have negativity, we all have negative tendencies in all of us. And Navratri is a wonderful opportunity to overcome all these negative tendencies in us. Generally, people do fasting. And what does the fasting does? It purifies your body and mind. Even the science and the yogic science also says that when you do the fasting, it will purify your body and mind. People used to be in silence. What does silence do? It purifies your speech. Listening to speak scriptures. Generally, people read, you know, Devi Mahatmya and all those things. This is purifying your wisdom. Devotional songs. People play devotional songs, sing devotional songs, bhajans and all those things. That purifies your emotions. And after doing these Navratri sadhana, after doing these 9 days, you overcome all your vices, you overcome all your negativity, and the 10th day is celebrated as Vijayadashmi. Vijayadashmi is winning 10th day, winning day, or winning, the celebration of the winning, Vijayadashmi. When you do this sadhana, you win over all your negative tendencies, and that is why the 10th day is celebrated as Vijayadashmi. you win over all the vices, all the negativity within you. So today's practice, as I told you, we'll do Shakti Samagama Sadhana. Okay, I'll just guide you. You have to practice that. What is this Shakti Samagama Sadhana? As we all know, most of you know, you have seven.